This is AIGA. We believe design inspires the world, especially when we inspire each other. As designers, we are more versatile than ever before, and our work has unprecedented power to influence everything around us. When we work together, we learn from each other, we support each other, and we inspire each other. Together, we are stronger than we could ever be on our own. And only together can we ensure that everyone, not just designers, but everyone in business, government, the media, and the public, understands the potential of design to change everything. We are AIGA, the Professional Association for Design.
Good evening. My name is Jess Moore, president of AIGA Colorado. Tonight, we'll hear about thinking inside the box with variations on a rectangle. You may have noticed that the AIGA logo is such a box, and I'd like to encourage you to think inside that box for a moment. I am coming to the close of my presidency. It's been a wonderful 2 years. I've enjoyed getting to know each and every one of you. And I've enjoyed working with Elevating Design in Colorado. I joined AIGA 11 years ago as a sole designer in Maryland. I was working as a sole designer in an accounting firm, and I needed to have an outlet with other designers. I moved to Colorado almost four years ago, and again, I was able to find my graphic design tribe by being involved. My career direction has changed. I get to teach design and see students blossom in the field, and I've launched my own design business. Thinking inside that box, I can firmly say that all of my work is made richer from my time spent at AIGA Colorado. I'm calling on you to consider nominating a friend or yourself for the AIGA board. We have openings for the next year in a variety of positions, and the deadline is tomorrow night at midnight. Other upcoming events include the U360 Design Show on May 11th with a presentation from Rule 29's Justin Ahrens. In May, also we have Flowers Blossoming with our Fellows Gala on May 19th. And we'll be launching our Elevate poster program, where we'll be focusing on empathy. You can sign up as a student designer or as a mentor for the program. Thanks to the Creative Circle, the Denver Art Museum, and the Design Council as our sponsors for this evening. We also have 5280 Magazine here as well tonight. I'd now like to introduce you to Mike Hayway, our Speaker Series Chair.
Good evening. I should mention that you have all held on to your raffle tickets, I hope, which are your little stubs here. We'll be giving away a few books at the end of this, and also we'll have a Q&A. So think of some questions so you're not on the spot at the very end here. DJ Stout is by definition an American graphic designer, his work rooted firmly in an American culture. Perhaps this is due to his geographical location, where he spent 13 years as the art director for Texas Monthly, prior to taking the helm of the Austin branch of Pentagram in 2000. Or maybe it is the product of a childhood spent moving across the United States as the son of a Marine. If our experiences directly impact how we see and interact with the world, then there is no doubt that these conditions have influenced this prolific and diverse designer and creative director. Paula Scher, one of DJ's partners at Pentagram, has described him as, quote, funny and pithy and brilliant, end quote. That his work can range from being, quote, broadly funny to devastatingly powerful. This is evident when poring over his body of work, work which spans between the fun and quirky, featuring Warhol-inspired glamour shots of bovine specimens for Dairy Today, to the powerful and sublime cataloging of the death and destruction and devastation of war in, quote, well, excuse me, in war/photography, images of armed conflict and its aftermath. Another set of examples demonstrating the diversity of a subject matter is the design of the coffee table book, Naked Ambition, an R-rated look at an X-rated industry, which documented unretouched photos of actors from the adult industry and other paraphernalia. To the poignant and yet still painfully relevant 1993 photo essay for the Texas Monthly magazine named KKK Encounters, a story revolving around an incident where the last African-American resident of Vidor, Texas, was chased out of town by the Ku Klux Klan and found dead the next day. If you do not already own a copy, I must recommend the book that tonight's lecture shares its name with, Variations on a Rectangle. It is the documentation of 30 years of graphic design spanning DJ's work for Texas Monthly and to his work as a partner of Pentagram from 2000 to the date it was published in 2015. So it's my pleasure to introduce DJ Stout.
Well, thank you very much. I have to say that is one of the best introductions I've ever gotten. Normally, I just send in like my little bio, and they just read it. And my bio is way too long, so then I started sending really short bios now. But thank you very much, Mike, and thank you, AIGA, for having me here to Colorado. I had to come all the way from Texas. I love Colorado. I'm going to talk a little bit about some work I've been doing in Colorado. But the first thing that I want to tell you is that I think I could. Oh, let's see. This is where I'm from. This is an area of far west Texas called the Big Bend, and I don't know if you know that area, but I'm originally was born in Alpine, Texas. I go back there a lot. But I was asked 2 or 3 years ago to do a lecture at an event called Design in Daba. And I don't know if you've ever heard of that before. It's a really great design conference in South Africa. And so it was in Cape Town. And I did this whole kind of Texas-y thing with a piano player and all this stuff. And I was wearing a black cowboy hat, and the lighting was kind of like this. And afterwards, Stefan Sagmeister, who's a friend of mine, was also speaking at this conference. And we were in the bar afterwards, and he kept telling me, DJ, I have something to tell you. I have a critique of your, you know, and I was like, okay. So I was like, Stefan, now are you going to tell me your critique? He's going to give me this big critique. He said, finally, when I tracked him down, he said, you never wear a hat on stage. Because apparently, when I was wearing the hat, it threw a shadow on my face. So I'm going to take my hat off. That's what I learned from Stefan. So now you can see my face. So I did I had a book published, as Mike told you, and so there was also this really great photographer out of New York who did a film, and so I've kind of taken this opportunity to throw in a little bit of a film snippet. So this first part is about a little bit about where I'm from.
There's something about living in a big empty space where people are few and distant under a great sky and a wind that never seems to rest. There is something about that big country that not only tells an individual how small he is, but steadily tells him who he is.
If I was introducing DJ to someone, I will always say, well, he's a Texan. I think some people resist stereotyping, and I think in a funny way, DJ Stout revels in stereotyping.
I was born in Alpine, Texas, which is a tiny little town out in West Texas in an area called the Big Bend. My father played baseball there for about 3 years for a semi-pro baseball team. And then he became an officer in the Marine Corps, and I moved every single year of my life. So I was always the new kid on the block. And my dad was also a sports writer. Through his encouragement, every little town that we moved to, I would do a newspaper. Or, you know, when I started school, I would, you know, ask the school if they had a newspaper. And if they didn't, then I would start one. That's when I really learned that a great way to make friends was to put together a newspaper staff, because then you had a bunch of people that were kind of forced to hang around with you.
When I first started doing my variations on a rectangle, I started doing these little newspapers. So that photo is, my dad was in the Marines, and for some reason we lived on a lot of Air Force bases, so this was when I lived in Bedford, Massachusetts, and I did the Sea House Weekly was the name of the paper. And because my dad had been in journalism, he bought me an old mimeograph machine, which was like the blue ink that, like, a lot of you here probably don't remember, but you, like, the teachers would pass out the test and everybody would smell them, you know. So I had one of those old machines. So that's kind of when I started doing magazines, and that's why my book is called Variations on a Rectangle. Michael Beirut, who just spoke there, is one of my dear friends. I've been a Pentagram partner for 17 years. He basically published a book that came out the same time as mine. And we happened to be featured in the New York Times Book Review, which is a great honor. I actually wrote a lot for my book for a graphic designer. I wrote like 50,000 words, and so did Michael. And he's a really good writer. But you can tell how tight we are. I worked on my book for 5 years, so did Michael, and when both books got reviewed, both of us didn't even know we were doing a book. but what was interesting about it was when my book came out, the Texas Observer came out with this really nice review, and the headline was, DJ Stout, the man who designed Texas. Michael had a review in the New York Times. The headline was, The Man Who Designed Manhattan. So I called him up and I was like, hey, Michael, I designed this big ass state. All you designed was that little bitty island. So this is what the book looks like. And it's set up like this. So I actually set this presentation up by the spreads of the book. And so as you can see, it's set up a little bit like an encyclopedia or something. There's like up there at the top, I don't know if you can see it, it says society is the big category. And then I think it says crime, so society and crime. So it's kind of set up that way. It was a way for me to kind of organize the work that I've done like over 35 years. This particular story, as you can see, I wrote a lot there, see? No graphic designers will ever read this book. But what's interesting about this cover was I was hired by Texas Monthly having never designed a magazine before. So this is my very first cover. And you can see it's very dated looking. This is 1987. And everybody at a magazine like Texas Monthly is very worried about newsstand sales because it's a newsstand magazine. And I had never designed a magazine before, and I kind of like snuck my way into this position. I was really, you know, I wasn't that nervous about it. This cover came out. It was the best-selling cover in the history of Texas Monthly. And I was like, oh, this is nothing. And so I was walking around. My head was so big. I was like, doing newsstand covers that sell is no problem. That little cover right there, that's my second cover that's in the side there. And it was about Van Cliburn, who's a famous Texas pianist. It was the worst selling cover in the history of Texas Monthly. So I got the best selling and the worst selling out of the way all in the first two issues. This is probably the most famous cover I did. when I was at Texas Monthly, I was there for 13 years. And because I wrote a lot, I wanted to just read the first paragraph of this piece. It's called Not So Easy Rider, How Ann Richards Got on That Bike. Ann Richards, the charismatic former governor of Texas, passed away on September 13th, 2006. And shortly afterward, I attended her memorial service at the Frank Irwin Center in Austin. The cavernous arena was filled to capacity with her many admirers. A choir wearing long cardinal robes and gently rocking back and forth sang gospel songs while snapshots from Ann's life projected on the wall of the arena overhead. The slides were set on a slow timer, so when one image faded out and a new one came up, it generated a spattering of polite applause around the arena. There were pictures of Ann as a little girl and shots taken of her early in her political career, but then seemingly out of nowhere, the Texas Monthly cover I had designed of Ann on a motorcycle flashed up on the wall, and suddenly, as if on command, every person in that arena stood up and began applauding and cheering wildly. It was a humbling and culturally intriguing moment, a crowd of thousands cheering for a regional magazine cover. How Ann got on that bike, or actually not on that bike, is a story that begins with her bid to be the second female governor of Texas. So then I go on and tell that story. I'm trying to keep this presentation to, I think you said 8:15. I'm going to try to do that. So, but I'll tell you how this cover happened. Ann really was riding high at that moment. And I was in an editorial meeting, and one of the editors said, Ann is really doing great. She's riding high. She could be the first woman president. I had seen a picture of Ann with a Harley Davidson motorcycle, and she was kind of posing next to it because she, I think for her 60th birthday or maybe her 65th birthday, she was quoted saying that what she wanted to do for her birthday was learn how to ride a Harley. So Harley Davidson sent her a motorcycle. And it's so much like Ann. You know, she was this feisty, very funny, very charismatic woman. And as our governor, you know, of course she would ride a motorcycle. And so this idea popped into my head. Well, long story short, I called her office. They said she loves the idea, but then she bailed out the last minute. And so I faked it. And so this was early on. So this was like before Photoshop was just a given. This was really difficult to do. We found a headshot, and then I photographed. That's not her actual motorcycle, because her actual motorcycle was kind of wimpy. I went and found like a big white hog in Dallas. I had that outfit made, that white leather outfit, because I thought about her white hair. And then we stripped her head in there. That was just a photo of her head. She loved this cover. So when she was alive, I used to run into her all the time. And she would always say, DJ, I love that cover of me on the motorcycle. You gave me the sexiest body. I wish I had thighs like that woman. She was great. And then there's other articles in here. This one is about how I've been overly influenced by Mad Magazine. And in particular, Alfred E. Newman. And so, as you can see, I've used the image of Alfred E. Newman 3 or 4 times. But I did a lot of work for Land's End catalog, and so I used Alfred E. Newman. But at Texas Monthly, when Ross Perot was running for president, I just had this idea, because he had been my client back in Dallas, that he just reminded me of Alfred E. Newman. And so then I came up with the headline, What Me President. It was kind of like a Trump moment. It was kind of like, you know, can this guy actually get elected? He didn't, but Trump reminds me a little bit of Alfred E. Newman. He did get elected. And then this is another story that I won't read the whole thing to you, but this is Tommy Lee Jones. Basically what happened on this photo shoot, we were doing the little cover there. it was called My Favorite Place, and we were photographing him at his ranch. And so this was right after he had been in Lonesome Dove. And so when I got up to his ranch, I didn't recognize him. Because in Lonesome Dove, he had a long gray beard, and he had gray hair. And he had shaved when I got there, and I don't know anything about actors. And so he thought that was funny that I didn't recognize him. And then we got up to this stock tank where we were supposed to photograph him. Had all these cows everywhere. And he asked me, what do you want to do? And I said, I want you to take your clothes off and get in the tank. And I'm going to take your picture coming up out of the water with a cowboy hat on. And he looked at me and he was like, boy, get the hell off my ranch. So I had to leave. And I had to call my associate at Texas Monthly to come to art direct the photo shoot the next day because he just was so pissed off. But he's kind of like that. But he's a great Texas character. So this is as you can see, the book is set up again. Here we're in the animals section. And so in that review, that New York Times review that I just showed you, the reviewer said that Michael Beirut's book was very, very New York, very Manhattan, that beautiful work, but there were no animals in his entire book. The difference is, all my career has been in Texas. My book has a lot of animals in it. So it's set up, like this part is called animals. This is just the horses. So this particular piece at Texas Monthly was about this horrific crime that happened in East Texas where these kids that were really bored saw a horse in a farmer's field and they went into the pasture and they took these sharp sticks and they stabbed this horse and killed it just for the hell of it. And they carved their names in the horse's carcass and left it out there to die. And I was so just horrified by this story. And the writer just did such an amazing job. It's a very Texas Monthly kind of story that I hired Matt Mehurin to do this illustration. And when the illustration came in, I was like, this is just really captures the emotion of this story. So because it had to do with kids, they were teenagers, and it had to do with like taking a stick and jabbing it and carving a name into a carcass, I did this hand-drawn type to kind of be childlike but also violent at the same time. So when I was at Texas Monthly, and even today, I did a lot of work that was hand-drawn type. And so I became known as, you know, that guy down in Texas who does all the hand-drawn type. I didn't do it all the time, but I don't hesitate to do that even today with all the amazing typefaces we have on with our computers. I do it all the time. And then what was good about this setup of my book is then I could do a Texas Monthly story like that one that I just showed you, but I could also do something that was like in 2011. That was also under animals and horses. And so this was a bunch of work we did for the Texas Book Festival. And there was some wildfires that happened out in the Big Bend, where I'm from. And so this painting by Mark Burkhart was a reference to those wildfires that were going on out in West Texas. And we got some criticism for that, but to me, I was like, well, that's the beauty of illustration, you know? It's a horse on fire. And this piece, for some reason, has become one of the most famous things I've ever done. I've done a lot, like I said, there's a lot of animals in my book. So this is in the cow section. So we have, these photographs were photographed by a wonderful Austin photographer named Randall Ford. And I actually have big prints of these cows all over my office. But it was a solution to a problem. The problem was that Dairy Today magazine came to us and said, we don't have a budget. And they were doing these horrible covers. Like, what they were doing was, like, they were doing stories about horrible diseases of cows and stuff. And so the writers would go and take pictures of, like, scabs all over the, like, the teats of the cows or whatever, you know. And they're putting those on the cover. And I said, you can't do covers like that. You don't have any money, so we're going to hire this photographer, Randall Ford, and we're going to photograph you 2 years' worth of covers for one photo shoot. You just pay for one photo shoot, and that's what we did. So I'm going to show you this. That's art direction in action. And for some reason, that little video just went ballistic. Like, it just went viral, that little video. But what was great about that was it was, what I've always said is that a lot of times a solution to a problem happens because you're in a tough situation. A lot of times, some of my best work like that happens because there was no money, there was no budget, or there's no time. And if you're a good designer, then you can, and I will not take failure for an answer. I mean, I've done a lot of failed work, but I'm gonna give it my best shot. And so that came about because we didn't have a budget. And so they ended up using that for 2 years, and then we did another shoot for another 2 years, and now they have calendars and everything else. And it launched that dairy today up to the top of the dairy magazine world, all three of them. We're still in the cow section here, and so this is Bat Cow. And so I don't know if you guys know about this thing. It's called Cow Parade. I'm sure they've had them here in Denver. There's these life-size cows. And it's a charity, it's a fundraising event. And what they do is they come into town, they have these, they're fiberglass cows, and there's two of them. There's one standing up, look with his head up, and there's one standing up eating, and there's one laying on the ground. And they go into a town, and they ask artists to paint the cows, and they put them around town, and then they auction them off for a good cause. Well, they came to Austin, and they asked me to do one. And I was like, oh, I don't want to just paint it, you know. And so I took the one that was laying down, and I worked with an artist, a fiberglass artist, and we made it into a bat. And I got permission, it took me a long time, from the city to hang it for 3 months underneath the Congress Avenue Bridge. So that's an actual photo of Bat Cow hanging under the Congress Avenue Bridge, where we have the largest, I don't know if you know this about Austin, that under the bridge live all these bats. We have the largest urban bat colony in the world, little Mexican free-tail bats. And so when it first was hanging there, the police got all these calls that there was a dead body hanging from the from the fence. And so, like I said, now we're in the snake section. And so one of my best friends is a guy named James Evans, who has lived in the Big Bend for 25 years. And he's a dear friend of mine, great photographer. And I designed his book, which is called, over there on the corner there, called Big Bend Pictures. I think I have a laser, see, right there. And lasers. And so when I was at Texas Monthly, there was this story about rattlesnakes. And so I called up James, and I said, can you go take a picture of a rattlesnake? He's like, okay. He went and he sent me this picture. I love that. I love that about, you know, West Texas. Like, it's no big deal. He just went. And so this was before the computers were very sophisticated. So wrapping that type around that thing was very, very difficult. And I drove my poor assistant crazy doing that. But also in the snake section, see, I'm able to go, like, forward and backward. So this is something I did fairly recently for a musician in Austin named Darden Smith. His album was called Marathon, where that's where my friend James Evans lives, which is Marathon is a marathon away from Alpine, where I was from. It's exactly a marathon away. And so we used the snake again. I had these photographs all taken in the Marfa area. So, you know, it's always a part of my work in some way. When I was at Texas Month, we're still in the animal section here, I called eight of the top illustrators of that day. And I called them like 6 months in advance, which is not a normal magazine schedule, because I knew about this story, which was timed for like Texas Book Month or something like that. And what we did was we found poems and excerpts from Texas literature all about Texas animals. And so, of course, us being Texans, we claim all these animals are just our animals, you know? And then I hooked it up, each one of those excerpts, with an illustrator. And so, for instance, Brad Holland did that one in the middle. Brad Holland's probably one of the greatest illustrators of all time. His assignment was about a rattlesnake. And so what he did was he did Pecos Bill, like swinging a rattlesnake. So that's why this is in the snake section. But what I did is I called all these, the best illustrators at the time, and I said, look, you can't turn this down, because a lot of times they turn it down because they don't have enough time. I said, you have 6 months to do it. Every single one of them waited till the very last second to do it. So that's just the way people work. And so also, I am a member of the Society of Illustrators in New York. I'm one of the few art directors that's actually a member of the Society of Illustrators. All my best friends are illustrators. I love illustration. I'm a big proponent of illustration. So in the book, every now and then there's a page like this that I called Primer. And this is all about how to art direct or how to work with illustrators. And the main point in there is that there's a lot of art directors and there's a lot of editors and publishers and magazines that hate illustration or they're afraid of it. Because illustration is very scary. Because you can't see it. You know, there is some stock illustration, but you can't see it like you can a lot of stuff. You know, you have to let the illustrator or the art director and the illustrator come up with an idea. They send you sketches, and the sketches scare people. You know, what is it going to look like? So my main piece of advice to I work with a lot of different universities and magazine clients. My main piece of advice is hire a great illustrator. That's the first thing. They'll work for you. If you have a low budget, it doesn't matter. If you give them some freedom, they'll work for you. Illustrators love to illustrate. Hire them, give them a synopsis of the story or give them the story, and then get the hell out of the way. And because what happens is, particularly young art directors, they try to art, like, well, maybe you should draw this and draw it exactly like that and whatever, and then you get bad work. The reason you hire great illustrators is because of the way they think. They're not draftsmen. You hire them because of the way they think, and that's my big beef with the way illustrators are actually approached in the way that they're overly art directed, basically. Now I've done my little speech. Okay, so this is another page in the book. This was a piece where there's a lot of cliche stuff, you know, like in Texas. But I love dealing with what I call the myth. And, you know, of course, Colorado, you have your own legends and myths that you can play with. You know, I love that about the West. So I was given the assignment that we're going to do a story about cowboy boots. And there were all these new cowboy boot makers at the time. And I was like, well, how do we do this in a way that's not cliche? So I happened to be in New York City and I went to the Museum of Modern Art. And I was walking through the photography collection, and there was a big Polaroid, 20 by 24 Polaroid, taken by William Wegman, very famous photographer who used this big Polaroid camera. There's only like four or five of these big Polaroid cameras in the world. And he was photographing his dog. Originally, it was Man Ray, and it was a Weimaraner. And then he was photographing Man Ray's puppy named Fay Ray. And so this is Fay Ray. But I was walking through the museum, and I saw Fay Ray wear a photo of Fay Ray wearing roller skates. And I was like, that's it. We got to do that. So then I had to track him down. He turned me down, first of all. He said, I don't want to sully my artwork. It's in all the major collections all over the world. I don't want it to be in some stupid regional magazine. Mm-hmm. But I convinced him to do it. And then he photographed it in New York. And then this piece, his dog wearing all these cowboy boots, this is just a couple of spreads. It won the National Magazine Award that year, which the National Magazine Award is like the Academy Awards of the magazine world. So this won National Magazine Award for photography. And when my editor went up to accept the award, he was like, I never thought that the way to win a National Magazine Award was just to put boots on a dog. So I think I'm doing okay here. Speaking of New York, in the book, at the end of the book, I talk about the sort of complex relationship I have with New York. I'm one of 21 partners. Half of those partners are in New York. When I got out of college from Texas Tech, and I'm a fifth generation Texan, I was on my way to New York. But I had a shitty car with no air conditioning, and I went to Dallas, and I got a job in Dallas. But I wanted to go to New York. And so I've always had this sort of complex relationship with New York. But I'm glad that I've stayed in Texas, and now I'll never go to New York. But I have partners there. And so this is about that.
Pentagram sort of grows a little bit by accident. We select partners sometimes based on location, sometimes based on specific discipline. DJ did such a wonderful job with Texas Monthly, but he was a magazine art director, which was not an avenue we tended to go into. We look for people who have, I would say, a more diverse background. But what made DJ plausible was he seemed to be a guy with sort of boundless energy and curiosity, which meant he could really learn anything.
The kinds of projects that I think of when I work with DJ are ones that require not just the sort of technical expertise that it takes to do good design, but it requires a kind of thing that I would just call heart. It requires like passion, soul, like a real connection to the material you're working with. DJ brings that to all of his projects. He's very good at kind of coming in, sort of seeing what the expectation is, figuring out some completely other way to do it, and then coming back to the client with that alternative and presenting it with such genuine enthusiasm and heart that the client often finds that, up till then, inconceivable, perhaps, solution as not just conceivable, but the obvious and irresistible choice.
So that was Paula Scher, as you saw. I don't know if anybody here has seen Paula's film on, there's a Netflix series called Abstract. It's really great if you haven't seen it yet. It really kind of captures her spirit and her personality. This series is, Abstract is about it's supposed to be all about designers, but there's one about a photographer, there's one about an illustrator. If you haven't seen it yet, you should see it. Paula is really instrumental in me becoming a partner. Paula was at CBS Records designing all the famous album covers that you probably know. That's when I first met her. And then she left that, and she was doing, she joined up with a guy named Terry Capel, and they were doing a lot of magazines. And so I kind of known her and her husband. Seymour Quast is a fantastic illustrator, her husband. And he actually was the one that recommended that I would potentially be a good partner. And so she was the one that kind of made that happen. So even though, you know, I'm in Texas, and I'm part of a big international group. We have a big office in London, and we have an office in Berlin as well. I have been able to do work all over the world, all over the country. So this, I still do a lot of magazines. I'm old school. I still do print magazines. Now, we do a website for the World Wildlife Fund as well, but I'm not going to show you that. But what Michael was just talking about there was kind of like thinking, you know, about a different way to do something. Well, this, the World Wildlife Fund, you know, they have the famous logo of the panda, and they're out saving all the animals, you know, all over the world. And so initially, of course, you would think that their magazine that we created would have like a beautiful animal on the cover. Well, we sold them on this idea of always just focusing on like a detail of an animal. So this one on the left right here, I'll get my thing here. That's a buffalo. And then when you open up the magazine, then that's a full spread of a charging bison. And so it reveals it. So this is a, that's bird feathers. This is a honeycomb. This is a tusk of an elephant. And that's a zebra, of course. And so we've been doing this magazine now for 4 years, I think, and they're a fantastic client. And this, once again, still in the animal section. I do a lot of work for higher education. So this is a research magazine that we do for Drexel University, which is in Philadelphia. And this is a story, is an opening spread for a story about these drill monkeys that were becoming endangered. And so, simple idea, I did like the international no symbol over a photo of a drill monkey. That's, I think, very simple like that. But I don't just do magazines. We do websites, we do apps, we do a lot of packaging, and we do a lot of restaurant work, a lot of higher education. This is a much beloved, it's becoming an institution in Austin called Lucy's Fried Chicken. And when we designed all their stuff, their logo, that script logo that says Lucy's, but the owner, who is from Abilene, Texas, he said, I learned how to cook chicken from my grandmother. And I want to do, his grandmother's name was Lucy. And he said, I want to do a sign that's a tribute to my grandmother. And I said, okay. And so he said, I said, what do you have in mind? I said, I want it to be like a hot chick with holding, kind of like, you know, like those 1940s, like World War II girls that were painted on the front of a bomber, you know? And I was like, James, this is kind of weird. That's about the tribute to your grandmother. He said, you should have seen my grandmother. So we worked with an old school neon guy named Evan Voiles, who has done all the neon signs on South Congress Avenue. He's a dear friend of mine. And it's just wonderful, kind of just doing something. Like, you can see the old school animation, how the girl kicks her leg up and down at night. And that's on South Congress. We've done 4 of these now, and they're just so much fun to do, you know. And by the way, that was in the animals birds section, because it's chicken. So then, now we're in the agriculture section. So this is the agriculture section, agriculture pot. So originally, this guy calls me, and he says, my name is Big Mike. And he goes, I want to do this magazine, and I love your magazine. guitar player, which I redesigned this magazine called Guitar Player, all about guitars. And I love this magazine you did, Dairy Today. I was like, okay. And he was being really kind of, I was like, what is the magazine about? And then he wouldn't say. And then finally, at the end, do you have a name for the magazine? He said, yes, Bigger Buds. And so I was like, oh. So this guy has a huge hydroponics company. So they make fertilizers, and like they have probably 100 different products. They're out of Vancouver, Canada. And so we did this magazine. And I said, how about Rosebud? It's a little bit more of a like a magazine name than Bigger Buds. And so we did this magazine. And then we started designing all the labels for all his products. Well, the first one was Big Bud. That's his main thing. And so I had this idea that I wanted to do it like an old school like grocery package, like, you know, Tony the Tiger or Mr. Clean or something like that. I always wanted it to be like a character, but then I also wanted it to be kind of infused with like kind of like a campy marijuana attitude, you know? Like what they do is completely legitimate. They make stuff, most of what they make is for, you know, people growing marijuana indoors, but they also have, there's a legitimate, like those little tomatoes, and you know, it's hydroponics or whatever. So we did Big Bud, and I worked with Mark Burkhart, who's a great illustrator, who did that Burning Horse. And we made Big Bud. I wanted him to be the Jolly Green Giant of Big Buds. But also we made him look exactly like Big Mike. And that was the first one we did, and Big Mike loved it because it looked exactly like him. And so, as you can see, we've done all these, and they're all very campy, and we're in the process of redesigning the actual packages. So I'm working with one of my London partners, Danny Vile, to redesign the actual package. So that kind of got us into this interesting area. So my partner, Emily Oberman, in New York, who I've done a bunch of work with, started and still does do all the packaging and all the design work for Snoop Dogg's line of cannabis products, which is called Leafs by Snoop. So, and so this is a very fertile area to get into because, fertile, because, you know, it's just, you know, it's been underground, and now there are places like Denver where it's legal. And so, you know, it's just, it's a great area to get into, to you know, because what she did was she actually designed it so it looked like a beautiful tea or like a beautiful coffee or a perfume or something like that, you know, and did this beautiful logo and whatever. And I actually kind of helped her on this a little bit. And so then we got this call from a guy in Denver. And so this was just a couple years ago, and so we came to Denver, and we went on a tour of all the dispensaries. Went to like a half dozen of them or whatever, and some of them are very Cheech and Chong, you know, like, as you know, and then some of them are, they're trying to be very upscale, you know, kind of like the Starbucks area thing. So we did this one, and they do extracts, and so we came up, we thought, well, it's extracts, so we came up with this idea of this little hummingbird that extracts, but it's also like a little bit of a pot leaf, you know, if you turn it around. So we've done the packaging for that, the whole line of packaging. And of course, we kind of use a different color bird for whatever strain it is. And so then that kind of led to this new project that we're just doing that I don't have anything to show you yet. But the guy who started Woodstock is a guy named Michael Lang. That's a picture of Michael Lang on the right there on the motorcycle. Back in 1969, him and his buddy started Woodstock. And as you know, this was the original poster. All these kids came from all over the country, and it was this amazing event. Well, Michael came to my office a couple weeks ago. He looks just exactly like that. And I kind of looked like that when I was his age, actually. And so we're developing an entire line of cannabis products with the Woodstock name. And we can use that bird on the guitar logo. And he was like, well, you could do another logo if you wanted to. I'm like, are you kidding me? That's like the most famous logo in the world. Why would I redo that? So we're busy working on that. But it's going to be a very fun project, I think. And so back to Texas Monthly. This is a page in the book where I was telling you about having to deal with either you don't have a good budget or some other problem. This was a story at Texas Monthly about a sheriff who was basically involved in smuggling marijuana across the border in South Texas. The guy, we couldn't photograph him because he was arrested. We couldn't photograph anybody. Illustration didn't seem right. So one of my staff members, her father-in-law was a sheriff, so I said, bring in the sheriff badge. Another one of my employees, I said, bring in a pot leaf. And so then we did this very sort of simple solution, and it worked perfect. You know, the sheriff who went to pot. And I wrote the headline, of course. And so, you know, back to some Texas Monthly stuff, what I loved about Texas Monthly was all the features, I didn't follow any particular format. So this was about, see those tough hombres up there on the, up there? That's a U.S. Marshals. And this guy's daughter, was that lady right here, her horse got stolen. And you don't steal horses in Texas. So these guys put together a posse and chased down the guy who stole her horse. And so I thought this is like a crazy story. It's like the Wild West. So of course I used kind of like old Wild West typography, and that's what was fun about that magazine. And we did, this is a fashion piece I did about cowboy hats. And then I hired Mary Ellen Mark, who's a dear friend of mine, who she passed away about 2 years ago, one of the best photojournalists of all time. I hired her to do this story, which was the largest piece as far as real estate goes ever in the pages of Texas Monthly. It was like, I think it was 20 pages in the magazine. She went to 14 different rodeos all over Texas, and she photographed the small town rodeo. And this is probably one of my most, proudest moments was this particular piece. But a lot of people in Texas hated this piece because they were like, that picture right there, I just love that. These young guys, they're wearing the cowboy stuff, so all of a sudden they are John Wayne, you know? But a lot of her pictures are that way. And so a lot of Texans thought, that's not the real rodeo. You're making fun of Texans or whatever, you know? But to me, it was a fresh new way to look at the rodeo. And so I really loved it. And I wrote all about it in the book if you want to read it. And then Brad Holland, who, you know, I said became a really good friend of mine, one of the top illustrators of all time. It turned out that to me, he was always a very Manhattan guy. He lives in Manhattan. He's lived in New York a long time. But his mother lived in Texarkana. And so he would go visit his mother. And he was so bored, he would go to the rodeo. And he would start painting and sketching. And he got the rodeo. And he got really enthralled about the rodeo clowns, you know, which are the bullfighters. And so he started sending me these paintings, and so I did this piece. And then back to Pentagram. Pentagram was founded in 1972, I believe, in London. And we have done these little books called Pentagram Papers, right here, since then. And so the partners take turns doing them, and you can just do them whenever you want. Sometimes we do two a year, sometimes one a year, whatever. So they asked me to do one because I hadn't done one in a while. And so, of course, I did one about cowboy poetry. So I knew about this cowboy poetry event in my town where I was born, in Alpine, where these guys go and perform this cheesy cowboy poetry, which I love, actually. And so I sent a photographer to go photograph it. Like, look at that guy's mustache right there. Hold on, I was gonna see. Well, yeah, there, look at that guy's. How can you beat that? So when I did that thing in South Africa, I had just done this little book. And we got permission by all these poets to run their poems. I had a whole bunch of these extra ones made, and I gave them out at that thing in South Africa, and people just loved this thing because it was so corny Texan, you know? And then I love the Texas brag, this idea that, you know, everything is bigger in Texas. So here's a map that I was asked by Sappy Paper Company, which is South American paper company, to do this. They sent me a map of Texas. And it was just an outline, like a coloring book outline. And of course, I made the state bigger. And then I designed it in a way where everything around it is misspelled. And then I love the Texas map idea, you know, because we have a shape. Unlike Colorado, which is right there. And so I've always said that, like, and this was for our 20th anniversary. We called it Planet Texas, so it's just a painting of the only continent is like Texas. See, that's a very sort of Texas sense of humor. So here's the entire country, you know, all in the shape of Texas. You know, it's just our sense of humor. We don't mean anything by it. That brings me to Colorado. So, of course, when I was asked to redesign the Coloradan, which is the alumni magazine for CU Colorado, CU Boulder, I designed it like a square. See? That little thing folds out as a square. And then, of course, we featured a buffalo. And then so we continue to do this magazine. And, of course, it features, like, mountain climbers, and, you know, mountains and space, because they do a lot of research with NASA. Here's more space. We do a lot of infographics. So this is about skiing, you know, Colorado stuff. And then we do a lot of identity work for universities, but we were asked to somehow distinguish University of Colorado Boulder from the other campuses. So we came up with this very simple idea of Be Boulder, because, you know, Boulder is a state of mind. It's like Austin, you know, it's a state of mind. But also it means like Be Boulder. So you can do things like, you know, Be Boulder in humanities, or Be Boulder in space exploration or whatever. But also you can do things like, when they have the orientation for new students, you can give them shirts to say, I'm Boulder. Or this means be Boulder in German, and so that's for in linguistics. So apparently that Be Boulder thing is all over the place. I was just talking to some people from, that came up here for, but what I love about working for this magazine is, of course, you guys have your own myths and legends and all those things, and you should take advantage of them. And then I did a whole piece on big hair, and this comes back to my roots again, because this lady right here, I just remembered when I went to school at Texas Tech how wonderful her hair was. It was this giant pink bouffant, and she was the tea cart lady at the Furs cafeteria. So we went back there and found her and photographed her, and she still had no idea why we took her to this old hair salon in Lubbock and asked her to have, can we take your picture? She had no idea why we were doing that. This lady right here sent me a picture of herself, a little snapshot, 3 years before we did this cover. That's a real lady. She said, "Dear Mr. Stout, I love to wear my hair in the shape of a cowboy hat. Will you put me on the cover of Texas Monthly?"
Oh, my God.
And so then I had to track her down. She'd been divorced 3 or 4 times. That's her real hair. So this is an animator who did Johnny Bravo for Loyola Marymount University. So that's in L.A. We do a lot of work for them. So my big hair thing won't go away. I love big hair. Lyle Lovett has big hair. So there's a piece we did about Lyle Lovett. A piece about Willie. He has a very famous guitar. So we did that type to look like a guitar. This is one of my favorite pieces we ever did. It's called The Last Picture Shows. And I worked with Dan Winters, who was one of the great editorial photographers of our day. And we went to all these abandoned movie theaters all over, small towns all over Texas. I'm going faster here, so, okay. And then this is a piece I did in 2006 over here for the Austin Film Festival. But once again, I'm, you know, instead of a lone star, it's like stars in her eyes, kind of a flag. But then there's my hand-drawn type again. And then this is a documentary by a guy named Turk Pipkin, where his group are building schools all over Africa. And so he did a documentary. And so there I am using, you know, this picture was taken of the first graduating class in front of a blackboard. So we stretched the blackboard, and I did the entire poster all like with chalk, you know. So I still love doing sort of hand-drawn type. And then this brings me back to my community. I don't know if you guys have a thing here called, it's called Picha Kucha. And my wife and I are co-chairs of this thing. We've done 27 of them now. And it's a speaking event that was brought over from Tokyo. It was originally created to get architects to talk faster. So it's like speed dating for creatives. It's like, we invite 10 speakers who are creative, and they have 20 slides each on a timer, 20 seconds per slide. So each lecture is like just barely over 5 minutes, like 6 minutes. And so I do a custom poster based on the venue. We always have it in a different venue. And we do these big, beautiful silkscreen posters. So I kind of love old printing techniques. And then we just give them away at the thing. But these have become kind of like collector's item. And what I love about them is that it's a project that I do and I pay for, and I don't have a client. So I can do whatever the hell I want to. It's one of the few projects I have without a client. But those are fun to do. And then back to my friend James Evans. I did that book called Big Bend, Pictures of the Big Bend Pictures. This is one of his latest books that I came up with the title, Crazy from the Heat, because he actually is sort of crazy from the heat. I used to go out there, and we would get in his pickup, and we start drinking whiskey, and we start shooting guns out the window. I'm sorry, I'm not proud of it, but he's totally crazy. So the book, this is the front of the book. And this is the back of the book, which is upside down, because it's crazy from the heat. And then finally, you know, you saw at the beginning that my dad played baseball in Alpine, and that's the reason I was born there. And so the very first book I ever wrote, I designed a lot of books, but the very first book I ever wrote was about my dad's baseball team. This Alpine Cowboys book. The reason I did it was I was just going to design it. There was another author who had been working on this for 7 years. He just fell in love with this story about this wealthy rancher. His name was Herbert Coconut Jr. And he owns, at the time, He owned the second largest ranch in Texas, next to the King Ranch. It's still very huge. But Herbert Coconut, and when I was growing up, all I ever heard about was Mr. Coconut, Mr. Coconut. And so me and my brothers thought his name was Mr. Coconut. But it's Coconut. But he changed my dad's life. My dad was from a very poor family in Dallas. My dad was a left-handed pitcher. He won the state championship, which was in Austin, when he was 19. He broke the high school record for strikeouts, 21 strikeouts in a game. And Mr. Coconut, this very wealthy man, walked out on the field and said, Doyle, that's my dad's name. That's my name too, Doyle Jr. was DJ. Said, if you come to Alpine and play for my team, my pro team, I'll pay your way through school. And so my dad ended up going to college and then not only that, getting a master's because of this rancher's love of baseball. And he built this beautiful baseball field in Alpine, which is still there. And I go every single year. And most years they ask me to throw out the first pitch because I'm the only one that ever wrote the entire history of the Alpine Cowboys. So it was kind of a, what was great about it is my dad was a career Marine and, you know, I was kind of a hippie and stuff when I was a kid. And so we were never that close. But doing this book, my dad lives in the Philippines. We did this book together and it really brought us together. And he said, you know, son, I never had any idea what in the world you do. You know, because nobody, like your parents don't know what art directors do, you know, or designers. And he said, now I know what you do, you know, because I did this book with him. So here's a little piece about that, and then I'm done. It's not that, but that. That's a poster I did. See, they're playing poker with PMS chips. Yeah.
I've designed hundreds of books in my 30, 35 years as a graphic designer. But the first book I ever wrote was about the Alpine Cowboys. And Coconut Field, as you see, is this beautiful baseball field. It's the home of the Alpine Cowboys. The reason I ended up doing this book about this very obscure baseball team in the middle of nowhere is that my father played for the Alpine Cowboys in the 50s. They had like a team photographer like most of that time, and he shot with a large format camera. And just beautiful photographs that he took.
All things meaningful kind of connect in one's life, and stewardship has always been a big part of mine. And as Chris and I are, and the crew here are stewards of this land, I think Mr. Herbert was a steward not only of this ranch and this land, but he was also a steward of baseball and those families, the players, and I think DJ is a steward of that story.
I guess you could say that I'm a regionalist. J. Frank Dobie was this really amazing folklorist and writer from Texas, particularly Austin, who really believed in the power of regionalism. He would always say that, you know, nothing really great has ever, you know, come from just trying to be global. The thing I love most about Texas is its character. Anything from cowboy hats and cowboy boots to politicians that act a certain way to oil men. I love taking advantage of that in my design.
There's something about living in a big empty space where people are few and distant under a great sky and a wind that never seems to rest. There is something about that big country that not only tells an individual how small he is, but steadily tells him who he is. I think that's a perfect description of Alpine and Lubbock and West Texas, and I think that the self-awareness that DJ has so strongly is very rooted in the experiences that he had in those places.
Yeah. And I guess we have, is there time for questions?
Yes, we have some time for some questions if you are willing to field them. So don't do what I'm doing, which is not talking into this. So when we hand this to you, please talk into the microphone so we can actually have this recorded. And you can come back and visit the on YouTube the video and actually have your question be heard. So does anyone have any questions? Yes, Jess?
What are three characteristics you would use to describe a good cover?
That's a good question. Because I still work with lots of universities and, well, you saw the World Wildlife Fund and whatever. And the thing about magazine covers that I learned over the years is they have to be simple. They really have to be simple. Because the way I like to put it is it's the advertisement for your magazine. And so I used to, I would think of these incredibly conceptual ideas, and I would just love the idea. I'd fall in love with this idea, but sometimes it was too complex. It was like, it was based on an inside joke, or maybe the image was too complex, or whatever. And so I think a magazine cover has to work the same way that like a billboard does, or an ad, because people have, particularly nowadays, have very limited attention spans. And that cover, the combination of that image and a very short, punchy headline has to grab the person's attention, and it has to say what that story is about, or you'll never get them to open the magazine. I know that wasn't three things, but I would say simplicity, and it needs to be they need to be emotional. I'd say simplicity, they need emotion, and clarity. It has to be like if it's too complicated, then it's never going to work. It's the same thing that happens like basically nowadays on blogs and websites and whatever, is you need an image and you need a headline, and it needs to say something extremely quickly and punchy, and it kind of works in the same way. Yeah.
We had one, Pat, and then we'll go to
Hey, DJ. I totally remember the mimeograph machine and the smell of those tests being handed out in classroom. Yeah. Thanks. So I have two questions for you. First of all, you talked about how you brought in all these resources, these photographers, these illustrators and writers, et cetera, that you brought in. How did you go about cultivating those relationships with those people and getting them to do work for low budget or no budget? That's number one.
Yeah, that's a good question too. When I was going on my little rant about working with illustrators, I have nine designers right now, and an office manager, and me. And we all nine of those designers are probably managing two or three magazines. And so we do a lot of magazines. And the main thing that I try to teach those editors and publishers and whatever is that you have to treat those photographers and illustrators that you're working with total respect. And if you do, then they'll work for you no matter what the budget is. Because believe me, I do a lot of university magazines. And I'm like, what is the art budget? And they're like, what is that? You know? And there's always a way around it. But if you, and what I mean by respect is, first of all, you treat like an illustrator, like I said, give them the synopsis. Don't tell them what to draw. They're not draftsmen. Tell them what the story is, because what that says to them is you want their thinking, the way they think. You're treating them like human beings, not like some machine that's going to, draw it for you or something. And the other thing, too, is when you get a great illustration, is design it with respect. Don't put type all over it. Don't crop it. Don't use it small. Use it in a way that actually helps the illustration. And I've been able to do that over the years. I've had illustrators and photographers, actually call me and say, wow, your design and your type actually made my artwork better, you know? Whereas a lot of times, it's the other way around, you know? And it's because they're not treated with respect. And part of that has to do with illustrators are misunderstood, and particularly by very literal editors. And I've worked with tons of literal editors, very literal people. They just think in a different way. And so, you know, I love writers, and I have a lot of my best friends are writers and editors. But you have to just realize that editors and writers think in a very literal way, and designers and illustrators and photographers think in a visual way. They're both communicating. They're just doing it in a different way, and you have to respect both of those. So,
thank you very much.
Thank you.
Question number two.
Okay.
So I see you have you said you have a team of 9 designers, obviously very strong people. So when you're looking to hire someone, what are you looking for? If you can give us a few key points.
That's a good question too. We hire like one I have an intern that lasts, I try to keep it around 3 months. So I have student interns, usually they're in the summer. And sometimes I have interns that last like 6 months, but I try to revolve it around a little bit. I hire a lot of my interns, most of them, because I think that's a great proving ground. And all the people I've hired over the years, I never look at their portfolio. I just sort of believe that they probably have decent work, because and this sounds really snotty, but actually most student work is not that good anyway, so it's really hard to judge. I'm just saying that they're gonna part of like when they start working for us, they're gonna learn a whole new way of thinking and a whole new way of designing. Anyway, what I'm looking for is do I like their personality? Do I just like them? So I sit down with them, I go have a beer with them, I you know whatever, and I just know immediately. And usually though, they come to me with a lot of times like a professor will send me a little note and say, this is an exceptional person. You need to, you know, pay attention to this person. And that happens all the time. But I can just tell. I can just tell right away. Now, I have had some, you know, interns and entry-level employees that, you know, didn't fit in. And then they kind of know it, and so then they leave. I've never had to fire anybody, like in 17 years or whatever. You know, at Pentagram. I think it's just a sort of a gut instinct is how I do it. You know, do I like them? Do they feel like they're going to get along with it? I have a very close-knit office. It's a fairly small office. You saw some pictures of it there. The computers are lined up like a newsroom. They're all in a row, stand-up desks. They can sit on stools, but they choose to stand, and they're just shoulder to shoulder. And I don't allow headphones. And you know, at first they're like, oh, he's so fuddy-duddy old guy, you know, he doesn't like music or something. I do it because the reason we're set up like a newsroom is because it's a team, and it's a really tight-knit group. They all love each other. They hang out after hours, you know. They don't invite me, and they just really support one another. But they work like a team. So what happens is, what happens when you have on headphones is you're not paying attention to who's next to you. You're just disappearing in your own little world. I let them play. We play the radio loud. We have 6 dogs that are running up and down, barking, the fucking heads off, and everything. You know. So you know it's crazy in there, and it is kind of annoying, but. Like if somebody is like, I need, what's the command for this? They just yell it out, you know? And also, I make all my designers responsible for their projects. They are directly talking to their clients. I'm always there somewhere, but I make them directly responsible and manage their projects. And they love that because it builds their sense of worth, but not only that, it cuts lack of communication because they're talking directly to that client. So they can't blame it on some in-between. They can't blame it on an account executive or somebody like that, you know. And so they're constantly on phone calls where it's not going right, and you can see the other designer writing a note, say this, you know, like whatever. So they were really working like a team, you know. It's really great, actually. So thank you.
Hey, DJ. It's Rick.
Oh, hey.
You let the cat out of the bag. What did you do for EDS back in the early big data days, or did you just work for Ross like as a personal designer or something? Like,
So I started my career in Dallas working for a guy named Robert A. Wilson, and it was a small design firm. I was right out of school, Texas Tech, on my way to New York. Decided to go see my uncle in Dallas. Ended up getting two job offers in Dallas. Started working for Bob Wilson. Bob Wilson's kids were like middle school. They were Luke and Owen Wilson, like the movie star kids, who to this day are really good friends of mine. But they just were mess ups back then. Still are, I think. We were doing a lot of annual reports. So one of my first clients was Ross Perot when EDS. So I just remember, like, I was just a kid out of college, going in there, presenting my concept for this annual report. And I had on jeans and a crappy t-shirt, and I had long hair, you know. And Ross Perot cut me off, like, in a half second. And he wouldn't listen. He's like, you know, boy, get out of my office. And it was like a whole, all these guys in suits in there and stuff. And then Bob Wilson took me aside, and he said, DJ, the first thing you gotta learn is if you walk into a room like that, like an art director or a designer, if you look like one, you've lost the game before you even entered the room. Anyway, thank you very much. I think we're going to... Okay. Yeah.
Your magic fingers. So it looks like we have... first, we will be doing the book. So three of these. So get out your tickets here. And then we'll have a couple canteens from the Creative Circle. So. And then we have an Adobe CC membership, I'm just now told, as we see. So, why don't you do the honor? So let's, we'll wait and then we'll confirm and you can come up. And
so the, just the last two numbers?
I'm not sure. Maybe
last two,
three maybe?
Last three numbers are 7, 3, 8.
There it is.
Oh, wow.
All right. Next, for number two,
7, 2, 4. Yay!
And number three.
7, 2, 5.
There it is. Yeah. This is, I mean, this was...
This is all mixed up.
let's put those three there, okay. And then we'll do the Adobe CC raffle. This for 1 year? 1 year.
Talk to me when you get it.
Right. And then talk to her. Boom. There it is. Yeah. Nice. And now for our little Creative Circle canteens, which you can fill with whiskey or bourbon. And then shoot out of a pickup truck in outside of Marfa, Texas. Yeah.
7, 6, 4.
Woo! Those two rows, I'm beginning to get a little suspicious of here. Yeah. And then last one.
Okay. I'll try to mix it up.
Right, yeah, I was shaking it, so I don't know what's going on there.
7, 4, 0.
I apologize to the other rows. I guess I don't know what to say. Can't take that back. So thank you very much. Those who have, I guess that two rows can come up. We can go from there. So thank you. I appreciate it. Thank you, Mr. Kevin.